Miguel Caballero from Twitteris.
Thank you, Sebastian.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Thank you again, Sebastian, for having me here.
Well, I'm Miguel. I come from Madrid, from Spain, and I wanted to share and to discuss with you our vision on how education is changing with the help of blockchain, applying blockchain to this industry. All right, so yes, let's go over there. I think we have around 15, 20 minutes. Sebastian,
it's up to you. Is your special guest today.
Okay. So feel free to pick me questions during the presentation or after when we finish. All right. We have time until 8, more or less. So feel free, whatever you want. Okay. We started this project with a very clear vision to reach a lot of people in a lot of countries. All right, so our vision has been always very ambitious to change the life of 100 million people in 3 years, improving their lives through education. And when I say improve, I refer to let people to earn money with education. Okay, so you will see how from a very classical industry is the educational industry. We can change this industry with blockchain and make things completely different than the ones people and companies were doing until now. We are not a new company. Tutelus.com is a 6-year-old company, and we are working since 2013. Tutelus today is the biggest educational platform in the Spanish-speaking world. We have around 1 million users, students, in 160 countries, and we have around 130,000 active video courses. So we are an horizontal platform based on video courses, based on video, where anyone can be a teacher or a student or both of them. So Sebastian can be studying Solidity, for example, and Sebastian also can have a course of, I don't know, how to...
Metal detecting.
Whatever you can imagine. Okay, so we as an horizontal platform have courses of everything you can imagine, from technical skills, sales skills, how to make a paella, how to run a marathon in less than 3 hours, or whatever thing you can imagine, because it's the community the one who produces the content. We don't produce content. All right? So this is the old model. We come from Tutelus.com. Tutelus.com is a centralized platform. And we started at the same moment, more or less, than the big players in the collaborative industry did it. I mean, Airbnb, Uber, all these platforms. Okay, so we have the good and the bad things of collaborative platforms and centralization. I will see them after. Also, and in the startup world, I think this slide is very important because we have combined last 2 years. Big growth with a profitability, and this is something really difficult, I think, from my point of view in the industry, because if you want to grow, you are not profitable. You need cash to grow, and if you want to be profitable, you cannot grow. So last 2 years have been very very hard years for us, but we did it. So we finished last year with an EBITDA of more than 300,000 euros, and we are a profitable company, all right? We also work with a lot of different partners, both from the ICO or decentralized project, is this one, and also with the classical model of content, because as I told you before, we don't produce content. So we have content from users, and also we have content from universities. From a decentralized point of view, we work, and I will speak after of them, but we work with Consilium and Startup Token for the advisory roadshows to different parts of the world. We work with Cryptonomous as the main ICO retail platform for ICOs. This is a very important company. We work with Donnelly for all the different translations to the website, documents, etc. of the ICO, and with other companies. This is one very interesting. And I think, I don't know if you start talking directly, yes?
Yeah, sure. Actually, the beta tested for the main beta releasing. So
we have the first partnerships in the in the blockchain industry, for example, with a company like Indos, because they are like a decentralized LinkedIn, and we are a platform where you can learn. So there's a lot of match between the skills you learn into Tellus and the process to prove, to endorse these skills over the blockchain. So this is a very interesting point. There will be, of course, a lot of different agreements in the future, not only to Tellus, but I think in the blockchain industry, and endorse to Tellus is one of the first ones. All right, so yes. And I'm here with this project because this sentence is very hard, but it's real. Education sucks. Education, to learn, is not something very sexy, very cool. Always to learn something is a hard process, right? And you need to be very focused. You have to, you need money also. Studying is sometimes it's free, but the quality of the free education is not so good as it should be, so you have to pay. And the second point is very important, because teachers are very badly paid always, and I'm not speaking about the quantity of money they receive. I mean, if I'm a teacher in an educational platform like Tutelus, Udemy, Coursera, or University of La Sorbonne, is it okay? I'm a teacher, and I don't get more money depending on the excellence I generate in my students. If my students get a job, for example, I don't get more money. So teachers are not really motivated to learn in any kind of platform, okay? And of course, there is no match between employment and education. I don't know here in France, but in Spain we have a lot of young people unemployed and a lot of hundreds of thousands of companies looking for technical people, and there's no enough people never to attend all the demand needs, okay? So these are real problems in education, and this is not something that to always have us as company to tell you. This is something that happens in any company of the sector. And this is the reason from a metric point of view, from a startup point of view, is that the recovery of users, the cohorts of users, are very low in this industry, all right? In the first applications, the cohorts we have is always near 100%, 80%, 90%. I mean, everyone is accessing to Facebook, Telegram, Twitter, and so on, every day, every week, every month. But in education, maybe you have to go here to tell us to learn something of JavaScript, because you have, or you are in a project of JavaScript, and you have to improve your JavaScript skills. But after you make this course of JavaScript, you don't go again to the platform because you don't need it. So the cohorts are very slow. Okay, and this is a real problem all educational platforms have. And this is because education sucks. Okay, people are not motivated to study. So we were thinking in January of last year, of 2017, what about if we could revert the model and making something very sexy for users? And there is nothing more sexy than paying users for learning. So we test this with our users. What about if we paid you to come back to the Tellus and to learn something more? And of course, people got crazy, because if we decided to pay them depending on the activity they generate in the platform, this is something very cool, and this is something everyone wants. If I go to Facebook and I get money each time I post whatever, it's fantastic. So this is the main reason, and of course the metrical reason after this sentence is to increment revenues. If our revenue is monthly active users multiplied by conversion, and conversion is the number of clients we have divided the number of the users, if we have much more monthly active users, because people are every month accessing to the platform because they earn money, and the conversion also is higher because everyone is learning more. Because if I am a user who wants to give money, to earn money, through tokens, I have to help all of you Okay, so people are happier, the conversion will be higher. So if we have more MAU and more conversion, we'll get much more revenue. This is the main philosophy to start to change in a new model, start to think in a new model. So we deployed two tokens. We deployed a solution where we managed two tokens, one little token that I will tell you after, but the most important thing of this slide is to consider that if a user made a lot of activity, they get more tokens. The more things you do in the platform, the more tokens you receive. Any of you, for example, knows or use Steemit? Steemit.com? This is something similar with Steemit from the point of view that if you post in Steemit, you can get money through tokens, depending on the quality of your post. If you get more likes, you get more money. If you get more comments in your post, you get more money. So here the philosophy is very similar. If you make things, and what is the meaning of things? For example, if we have courses, if you watch minutes of videos, you get tokens. So if you watch 1,000 minutes of videos on JavaScript, you get more tokens than if you watch only 10 minutes. If you solve questions of other students in your JavaScript course, you get also more tokens. If you help other students in their projects, because they are studying, for example, with JavaScript, and they don't understand different things, and you help them, you get more tokens. So the more things you make in the platform, the more tokens you get. By this reason, we deployed two tokens. One little token, which is the TOOT, and one token, that one internal token, that measures relevance. Is the STOOT or Smart TOOT. So, the STOOT is the really important token from the platform point of view, but it has no value. You cannot buy STOOT or you cannot sell STOOT because STOOT is a measure of the relevance you have. I mean, if I have a lot of STOOT in JavaScript, it means that I know a lot of JavaScript. If I don't have STOOT in JavaScript, I know nothing of JavaScript. So I cannot buy my knowledge. Okay? This is something, I don't know if you remember, for example, Matrix, when Neo puts here a chip and I know Kung Fu in 2 seconds. You cannot do it in the real life. Okay, so you cannot buy STOOT. But the liquid token is the TOOT. So the TOOT is the token who is in the market. The TOOT is the token you need to access the platform to different services, we'll see after. And the STOOT is the measure of your relevance. So this is the tokens that you can buy yourself, and this is the token that you can earn. Nothing more. It seems complicated, but it really is very simple. So the token will increase the value because of a very simple reason. If we have each time less tokens in circulation because users, and you'll see after, users are they hold their tokens to make different things in the platform, and each time we have more demand of tokens because we have, and I will explain you after, different revenue sources through token and only through tokens from companies, from teachers, and from students, the price of the token from a financial point of view has to rise. All right. So, I'll pass, this is not important, I think this is much more important, how the token works. Okay, I go into a course, okay, I'm a student, and I go into a course. I can go inside a course, free or paid course, okay? All kind of courses give tokens to users. The maximum number of tokens you can earn, the maximum quantity of money you can earn in a paid course is the price of the course you paid. So if you are making a course of 30 euros, the maximum quantity of money you can earn is 30 euros. It's impossible to earn 300 euros in this course, okay? And there is only one person, I am describing you the mathematical model behind it. There is only one person being able to earn the maximum quantity of money. And this is the one who earns the more tokens. From this person below, it decreases, okay? So the maximum quantity of money is the price of the course. And if you are in a free course, the maximum quantity of money is 10% of the medium ticket of the courses in this subcategory. So if, for example, the The promedium price in JavaScript courses is 30 euros, and I'm making a free course of JavaScript, I can earn maximum 3 euros. Okay, so everyone can earn money, and of course, in a free course, you can earn less money than in a paid one. So, I start to make the course. We generate a platform, the wallet for the user, and the user makes actions. So the more things I as a user make in the platform, the more tokens I get. So at the end of the course, when I finish the course, I as a platform ask to the user, what do you want to do with your tokens, with your relevance? What do you want to do with your studs, with your relevance? Do you want to trade by cash, or do you want to hold your relevance? If you decide, this is a true decision, and you cannot change it in the future, because it is after your decision, we send this information to the blockchain, and it's consolidated, okay? But you can decide if you want money or you want relevance. Why a user can want money and not relevance? For example, if I live in Venezuela, the monthly salary is around $30. Okay, so this business model can be like a second, a third, or a main revenue source for myself if I live there. So I'm interested in earning money. But if I decide to trade the stud for toots, this is a very simple equation. 50% of the stud I have, we transform them to toot, and the other 50% is relevance. So if I was until now the first guy in the platform, for example, in JavaScript, because I hold until now 100 tokens, and I decided to change the tokens, okay, I get 52 tokens, 50 liquid tokens, but my relevance now is the half, is 50. So there are maybe 30, 40, 1,000, 2,000 people with more relevance than me in JavaScript. And if I decide not to change the stud through toots, I decide to hold my relevance in studs, I don't get money in the short term, but I get relevance. So this is something like, for example, I don't know if you know Stack Overflow, how Stack Overflow works with the reputation. It's something very similar. So the more relevance you get in your skills, the more important and the more influential you are in the community. So, the third part of the equation is the companies. If I hold a lot of relevance in blockchain development, for example, and I live in Paris, a company can arrive tomorrow to Tutelus because they need to hire people in blockchain. So these companies will look for the people with most relevance in blockchain in Paris, and I will be the first one. So if I decided in the past to hold my tokens as relevance, it's because maybe in the future I have the possibility to have a better job through Tutelus, okay, and to be the most relevant in that point. So there are users interested in trading the relevance through cash. We think most of these users will be in underprivileged countries or underprivileged positions, okay? And there will be also a lot of users interested in holding relevance because they want to be influencers in the cities, in the communities they live. So even in this second case, the users will get more money, not only with a better job they got through the company who wanted to hire people of blockchain developers in Paris, because the quantity of money the company has to pay to Tutelus to hire these people, we share this revenue between the student, between you, between the teachers who participate in your learning process, in this case of Solidity or blockchain development, and between the company, okay? So this is a very fair share of revenues from the companies And this is a vision of the hiring industry, completely different to the classical one. I don't know if any of you have worked in the human resource industry, but this is something like very, very hard. If you want blockchain developers, the only thing you can do is to go to LinkedIn or to go to the classical Randstad or Manpower, these kinds of companies. You don't know if the people you are hiring really knows about Solidity, or maybe they were with people selling themselves, but they really don't know. But here, with the relevance, it's basically impossible to hire fake people, because if you hold a lot of relevance in blockchain, it's because you made a lot of courses and you were a lot of time spending your time helping other users in blockchain. So it's impossible to hire fake people with this model. All right. From a teacher point of view, the model is also very interesting, because in the industry, in the educational industry, in our competitors like Udemy, for example, the only source a teacher has to earn money is this one, selling my courses. So if I'm Sebastian, I have a course in Tutelus of blockchain, okay, I will get money selling this course, but no more revenue sources. So with our model, we hold also a subscription model where we pay teachers depending on the time the users are in our courses, but also the teachers are users. So if the teacher helps other users in their courses or in other ones, of course, they get money. And if the teacher is involved in the learning process of the student who got a job through the platform, again, they get money. Okay, so four revenue sources compared with the only one. And the most important thing of this slide, and if you were a teacher in the Collaborate platform, you'll know it, is this one, instant payments. In any Collaborate platform, you pay your users, your providers, when you get the money, not before. So you as a user can think, if we sell a course today, we get the money instantly, but it depends on the country. For example, we work a lot in Latin America, and in Colombia, Venezuela, Bolivia, we have a lot of local payment methods, and maybe we need until more than 100 days to take the money from these countries. So we cannot pay teachers until 100 days. So with tokens, it's something completely different. It's instantly. Okay, so we are sure this is a model that will attract new teachers in other languages to the platform. How the model works from a tokenomics point of view. Tokenomics, if you don't know the word, tokenomics is the mix of tokens and unit economics, okay? We start with a very amount of, important amount of money in scholarships. This is the, we call it a pool of two tokens. Okay, so we have around $20 million, the idea is to have around $20 million for scholarships. We led with this money to study free for a lot of people. So imagine, for example, we are in Venezuela and we have, 100,000 people there, and we give them one scholarship of 10 euros, for example. So we spend $1 million with people from Venezuela. We get these people to discover the platform and to learn whatever they need. We will prefer, for example, these people in technical courses. So we'll create the scholarship for IT courses, web development courses, for people from Venezuela. These people study free, but when they go into the platform and they discover they can earn money through tokens, through the activity they generate, they start to help other people. So as they start to help other people learning anything of IT, and these people again start to use more the platform, and these people is being helped, and because of the first slides of revenue and monthly active users by conversion, we need more people paying, we get more people paying, we get much more people each month, and we get much more revenue. So it means in a financial model that at the first we give a lot of scholarships, and it seems we lose money. It's not a real loss, but we lose money. But after three quarters, we start to have a lot of people with relevance in different skills. So we can start after three quarters to offer these people to the market from a hiring point of view. So we need 3 quarters to form and to prepare people through relevance. After 3 quarters, we can start to sell this model to companies to help people. So from here, we started to combine the scholarships, but also we have incomes through companies through the hiring service program. Okay. So from the first moment, we have tokens through a scholarship of students. This is an output token way, but we have also 3 different revenue sources through tokens, and only through tokens. Companies who can pay only in tokens through to hire people, teachers who can pay only in tokens to promote their courses. Imagine, and this is a real situation, we have around 3,000 active teachers, and everyone wants to appear in the homepage of Tutelus because we have millions of visits each month, and this is something like in micro scale, but imagine like if we were Google, everyone wants to be in the first position of the first page, okay? So, okay, if you want to promote your course, you can do it, but paying tokens and only tokens. And again, if you live in a country where fiat money is a very complex a kind of money to use in the internet, like Venezuela, Colombia, Chile, Argentina, Latin America in general, you can pay in Tutelus through tokens. I mean, you here from Paris think this is not a real problem, but for example, in Venezuela, we have, between Venezuela, Cuba, Bolivia, we have 400,000 users and less than 1,000 clients because they cannot pay. In Venezuela, for example, it's impossible to pay in dollars or euros because it's forbidden for them to manage dollars or euros. So it's impossible. So if we let people the possibility to pay in tokens, we have a lot of people from other previous countries paying tokens. And of course, the price of the courses in tokens will be always 10% cheaper than in the fiat of the country. Always to incentivize the use of tokens. Okay, so the resume of this slide is that the tokenomics model runs, and in the long term we get a model where we have incomes in tokens, and despite of the fact we give scholarships to people, we have of course revenue from tokens. Why do we do this chain? Okay, this point, I think we have 3 big bullets because we are sure we can create professionals that don't exist today. Companies have a lot of problems in the hiring industry. We can solve this, creating these professionals, because we have the content, we have the users, and we need to match it. We need a lot of people, for example, now to study Solidity and JavaScript applied to blockchain and these kind of things, because we have the content and we have the users, and there are companies looking for these users. So this is very easy to solve. At the end, the most important point of this blockchain model is because we want to decentralize the governance, empowering people. At a collaborative platform, we decide everything in the platform. And I, as a CEO of the company, I think this is a mistake. For example, if you want, what's your name? Sorry.
Axel.
Axel?
Yes.
If Axel wants to have tomorrow a course in Tutelus, we as a company need to approve his course. And maybe it's a good course, but we decide tomorrow, I don't know why, to reject your course. Why? I don't know, because my colleague didn't like it, but maybe your course is very good, okay?
Sure.
So, so we are taking decisions, we are taking centralized decisions, but they are not really efficient decisions, okay? So it will be much better for the community, for example, if your course is of JavaScript, to have 3-5 people with a lot of relevance in JavaScript, and these people will decide if your course needs to be approved or rejected. Because these people know of JavaScript. I know nothing of JavaScript. I know about Tutelus and the business model, but I know nothing of your skill. So decentralizing the governance and empowering users to take decisions, and of course rewarding these users with tokens, is a much more efficient way to grow and to take decisions. Okay? And of course to improve the life of people and so on. So with this model, we get benefits for students because they earn money studying and they can pay in crypto. Nowadays they cannot, okay? We improve life of teachers because they get money at the moment and they earn money with different sources teaching better. We also benefit companies because they can access and hire people in a better way than they have until now. And of course, the main point for companies at the first is not to convince them that we have the best people in the world. It's very simple. How much do you pay to hire anyone today? They are paying companies, IT companies, are paying around 20% of annual salary of the guy. Okay, so if we are cheaper with this model, we'll prove it. And of course, with this project, we let a lot of people to go into the market and to discover the platform and earning to cap new users. This is the point. So yeah, I this is not something important from a technology point of view. As we are a real company working since 6 years ago, we have all these layers in production. These layers until now, before decentralizing the platform, were alive. Okay, we have incorporated the token to the platform, to the back office. This is the front end. This is the back end. And the token through API is connected to our backend, and the token is deployed, and this is something I wanted to share with you, in the blockchain name. Okay? We started to work with Ethereum. We were around 5-6 months working with Ethereum, and for our case, Ethereum was a nightmare. It was a disaster. Because we have to consolidate a lot of things during the course. If you are a user, and imagine you are watching minutes of video, we have to give you tools in that moment. I help other users with an answer and more tokens. I make something, more tokens. So during a course, we have to consolidate a lot of things inside the course and during the time. And using Ethereum, it means we have to consolidate a lot of different transactions. And this is something really expensive. And this is something really slow. So we had, during these months, we were, for example, I don't remember, like a complete disaster, the week in December where the CryptoKitties were in production. It was horrible because miners, Ethereum miners, were consolidating CryptoKitties transfers before anyone more, because they were paying around, I remember the gas, around 60 way of gas. So it was horrible to anyone that wanted to pay less, because the miners only wanted to take the transactions of CryptoKitties. So we cannot depend on a blockchain with high fluctuations of prices and of speed. With NEM, with Ethereum, we got until 7 transactions per second in the blockchain. Okay, with NEM, with the new version that is in production now, we jump from 7 transactions to 4,000 transactions. So it's something crazy. With NEM, we deploy 2 blockchains, 1 private blockchain to consolidate everything to zero cost. And this blockchain is the one, it's a private blockchain, is the blockchain who has the STUD token. And this blockchain is connected through an API to the mainnet, to the public blockchain of NEM. And in the public one is the TUT token. Okay, so we have 2 blockchains completely interconnected, 4,000 transactions per second. This second internal blockchain with zero cost. NEM has a lot of a lot of things we like, and Ethereum hasn't. So we decided to move from Ethereum to NEM just 1 month ago. So from that moment, we got a lot of support from the NEM Foundation. We are one of the best projects in the world over NEM. So I think this is, it can be difficult because we are one of the pioneers, but at the same time, I think this is a very important point also for the project. And yes, we are very fine with them. From the roadmap point of view, we want to have the token deployed even before of the ICO. We'll have the ICO in June. We start before the pre-sales, and we are now in a private placement position. Okay, we are traveling worldwide, showing the project and speaking with investors. So we want to have deployed the token in June, and after we have a lot of different features to deploy. And as we have 2 platforms now,
the centralized platform tutelos.com, the decentralized platform tutelos.io, we are decentralizing all the services of the centralized platform and tokenizing them. So we need approximately between 9 and 12 months to do it, and after 9-12 months the old platform will disappear, okay, and other platform will be decentralized. From a token sale point of view, we consider a hard cap of $40 million. Half of the money of these $40 million will go directly to the scholarship program I mentioned before, and so for the business plan is $20 million, and we'll accept a lot of different tokens, not only Ethereum, because we are going to make all the retail part of the platform, of the ICO, sorry, with Cryptonomous. I don't know if you know Cryptonomous. Cryptonomous is the first worldwide platform for ICOs from a retail point of view. Okay, we are discussing today, and I hope to be solved in 10 days, no more, but we are just discussing if we make the ICO from in Switzerland or in other jurisdictions like Estonia or even Lithuania, because we don't have problems to do it in Switzerland, but with Cryptonomous and the FINMA regulator, the Swiss regulator wants Cryptonomous to hold different license they don't have, so if we don't get this license very quickly, we'll move to Estonia possibly. Okay, so Estonia is something very, very simple and fast to work with. And only a few people. I think the most important of this slide is that the same people that built tutelos.com is building tutelos.io. So we are based until now in Madrid, and this is the main guys of the team. And I think I finish now with the same slide that I started. I'm sure we can help a lot of people with this model. We can produce that a lot of people in different countries earn money, learning. I think this is something very beautiful from a society point of view. And with this token sale event, I hope to be absolutely successful and do it very well. So thank you, guys. Thank you very much. Questions? You understood nothing? Yes?
I just have a question on the ICO and the pre-placing.
Yeah.
What discounts are you looking at, and who are you aiming to sell the pre-placed ICO with? Are you going to VCs or seeds?
Yeah. In the private placement, in the pre-sale, I started by the end. In the ICO, the maximum bonus will be 10%. In the pre-sale, the maximum will be 20%. And the minimum purchase will be 5 ethers, or the equivalent in other tokens. And in the private placement, we manage more bonus, of course, more discounts, depending on the quantity of money we are talking about, of course. And we are working with different funds. We have an official agreement, for example, with a fund from Price, with a Volta Partners. And we are working with different advisors like Consilium, like Startup Token, like others in the States, to start the pre-sale with part of the tokens commitment. Yeah.
I'm sorry, I came in late, and I just wanted to understand, because I understood that you were an ongoing business and you converted to blockchain, or did you start on blockchain?
No, we are a 6 years company, six years old company.
Right.
We are a centralized platform. We come from tutelos.com, and tutelos.io is the new platform based on blockchain.
Right. Okay, so my question there comes back to
Who
was financing you when you were a dot-com, and
okay.
Are those same... because you must have an equity structure.
Yes.
And what I'm trying to understand right now, and I think it's a good topic to be discussing in a forum, is the whole tokenization of equity.
Yeah.
And why are you going with an ICO as opposed to your already business and tokenizing your equity, which is becoming something that I know in Paris and in London everyone's starting to look at.
Yeah, this is a very, very good question. We were funded in the past with in the classical platform in the .com. We have around $1.5 million dollars of equity. Okay, but I started telling the old model, and the conclusion I suppose you weren't, but the conclusion of the old model is that scaling it is really hard because educational industry is a very hard industry to scale up, okay? Because education sucks and different things. I will pass you the you have this presentation in the website, okay?
Yeah,
okay. In tutelus.io. So we decided to change the model to decentralize the governance, and because of the reason to reach a lot of much more people with a different business proposal. With the classical one, it's impossible for us to reach 100 million people in 3 years.
No.
No, no way. No way if you don't have 50 million euros to spend in marketing. So we needed other model where users were more motivated to use the platform and to use the model. So we say, this is something we didn't design in one night over the paper. This is an evolution of maybe 9 months of work defining the tokenomics model. So yes, we are thinking about in tokenizing the equity after the ICO. I think this is a very good point. And the actual stakeholders of the company wants to do it because I'm sure they...
Excuse me, the stakeholders and the shareholders? The shareholders.
And
so would you... Okay. And that's just coming back to how are your shareholders reacting to an ICO? Are you giving them preemptive rights into the... Because in a certain sense, you're diluting them, but you're not really diluting them.
Yeah. This is... at the first moment, it was something hard because they don't come from the blockchain industry. They are traditional venture capitalists. So it was, at the first moment, really hard for some of them to understand the change. So yes, we offer them the possibility to buy tokens with bigger discounts than anyone from outside, of course. And after a lot of months, I think they understood well the challenge, and they are happy to be decentralized as shareholders, okay? They understand more. From a liquidity possibility or a liquidity event, to be tokenized is much better than to hold your value as shareholder because, you know, we need much more years to produce an event of liquidity without being tokenized than being tokenized. But, of course, this is an opinion. Yes, please.
Yeah, so I have a question, but just a comment first. This is not the wealth transfer everybody's waiting for. I mean, the blockchain industry is slowly pushing financial tools and,
yes,
and it's the wealth transfer everybody's waiting for. I mean, and so my question is, have you heard of your American competition, which is very good in my sense?
Yeah.
I'm a teacher myself.
Yeah.
So I'm interested.
Mm-hmm.
It's all Odell.
Yeah.
That's the name. So what do you think about them? What do you think about the market globally? Mm-hmm. How do you think?
I know them perfectly. I was, for example, our first competitor and friend is the guy from Udemy.com. Okay, they are in San Francisco. I was with them in the headquarters 1.5 months ago. And these kinds of companies are too big. My opinion and my perception is that these companies are too big to be tokenized, because tokenizing a platform is something cultural. It's not only technological, it's a cultural change. Decentralizing a platform is something very deeper, you know, and these people are too big to be tokenized. They have big venture capital. Their goal is to be in the public, you know, exchange. And well, I think they have their own way. We have ours, but the problems we commented at the first are the same in Udemy than in Tutelus. So I remember speaking with them, they told me, really, I remember the words, Miguel, if you do it and you get it, you break the market. You break the market.
Okay. And another point is we had Odin teaching in Germany and presentation, and we gave it. Different point of view.
More questions? Yes?
Maybe you could just explain, you changed from Ethereum to...
Yeah.
What, can you describe maybe some of the difficulties you have or the procedures? Because for me, I mean, just don't fork out. You have to put
yes.
everything one to the other. And do they provide service or you know, did Ethereum try to block you in any way?
Well, yeah, I think we commented, but I suppose you were right after. I don't want to say that Ethereum is a bad blockchain or it doesn't work well, because it depends on each model, okay? In our case, we have the need to consolidate a lot of small transactions, user transactions, during a course. So Ethereum is a bad choice because the cost of Ethereum are very high. Even when they are small, you don't control neither any blockchain, but Ethereum is one of the biggest ones, so it can happen anything in the blockchain that you cannot control, and the cost suddenly rise up a lot. And depending on the cost, also is the speed of the network. Ethereum is something very, very slow for us. So in NEM we have around 1,000 times more speed than in Ethereum. So combining costs with speed of the network and support from the own blockchain. And this other point, that main developers of NEM are based on Barcelona. So they are like colleagues from us. So it's they could be in Vietnam or Canada or Russia, but they are in Barcelona. So it's another point.
One last question,
maybe? Okay. Thank you,
guys. I have one question, just because that's something we didn't discuss last time we saw each other, which is how do you want to distribute the 20 million in scholarship, or do you want to
break,
and how would you?
Yeah.
Something I'm not totally sure.
We have like a huge matrix to distribute all these scholarships, but we want to start with the skills. We have like files and columns, okay, in the matrix. So we have to combine countries. It's more important for us, for example, to start doing scholarships in people where our users are, because we have the content there in Spanish, and also in skills. We want to boost first technical skills. So we are making agreements, for example, with foundations and NGOs to reach a lot of people just in one agreement. Okay, so yes, the objective is to have first year around $3 million in scholarships, second year about 10 million, and rest in the third year, and the model runs. Thank you, guys. You have my card, and anything you need, I will be there.